good evening to one and all present here. We have gathered here for yet another enthusiastic tech knowledge sharing platform, FAYA Port 80. It's been so long successful run for FAYA Port 80, and we expect the same ahead as well. With all your cooperations and engagement, it is going very fine and enthusiastic, so expecting the same this time as well. Before moving on to, let me thank the people who came here to join us and participate with this 42nd edition of FAYA Port 80. And let me proudly announce that this is the fourth session of FAYA Port 80 after NASCOM Association, and they have listed us officially as well. So this is a proud moment as well. Now, let me also thank the people behind who worked for organizing such a beautiful event. Now, as usual, FAYA Port 80 begins with Tech Bytes. Tech Bytes is it's usually a review or a nutshell of a few updations tagged under the category of technology. It's just to know what is actually happening around us. So for the same, let me invite my colleague, Mr. Sudhagar, to carry out the Tech Bytes.
Thank you, Rintu. Good evening, everyone. We can have, I'm Sudhagar, we can have a quick review on the latest technology updates happened in last month. First one is Apple's new release. So iOS 10.1 is released to have new feature added to the iPhone 7 Plus, the portrait camera mode, and also few bug fixes. And another release is under testing, 10.2. Beta 1, which is expected to be more stable release, and it will be having new features also. And also MacBook Pro, the latest version of MacBook Pro is released by Apple, which is faster and it is lighter and thinner than the previous versions. Also it is having brightest and colorful display ever has MacBook. And also it is having a new feature added to it, that is touch bar, which is a multi-touch strip added in the keyboard that user can easily access tools through this touch bar. We can have a quick video on this. You can see it. This is the multi-touch touch bar. Next one is debit card details hacked in India. So 3.2 billion debit cards, debit card information are hacked. So this is this breach is happened through Hitachi Payment Service. Hitachi Payment Service is the largest ATM, largest provider for ATMs, and this breach is initially happened through Yes Bank. Then it is affected affected ICICI, HDFC, Access and SBI banks. So the bank requested the affected customers to change their ATM pins immediately. And the next one is DDoS attack. So this DDoS attack is happened through the Mirai botnet malware, which is interacted with the internet connected devices, and the attack is launched through that. So due to this, huge internet outages happened. Initially, it has happened in the eastern United States. Then it is spread across the world. So it is fixed. And the last one is Microsoft Open Source AI Toolkit. So this is now released to developers as open source. And it is this tool kit name is Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit. And this is previously known as CNKT when it was in the in-house tool for Microsoft. And it is having an very intelligent deep learning algorithm which is faster than the current toolkits available in the market. And developers can use C++ and Python programming language to code this toolkit. And now it is available in the GitHub for as an open source license. If you have any other updates, if you know, then you can share it. Else, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sudhakar. Now let us move to the important part of FAYAPort 18. The relay of the month is test automation that will be led by our resource person, Mr. Sharath Verma Ashokan. So let us know him better with a brief introduction. Mr. Sharath Verma Ashokan is a senior consultant with over 11 years of experience in different software engineering areas like testing, requirement management, and implementing manual and automated software testing. He is an IBM certified specialist for rational test management and robot. He is well experienced in testing methodologies, creation of test cases, writing test scripts, and in use of automation tools. Besides being a consultant, he is also a trainer on testing tools like IBM Rational Functional Tester, Rational Test Manager, Rational Manual Tester, Rational Robot, HP UFT, HP Quality Center, HP ALM, Microsoft Test Manager, etc. Now the floor is all yours, sir.
Good evening, all. Am I audible? That's fine. So before starting the session, I would like to know, it's not possible to introduce all you people, but I just want to know one thing. Are you all from the development side or from the testing side? All? Development. Any other stream, I mean, other than testing or development? No. Yes or no? Yeah, no problems. We'll start. So so today we are planning to cover two topics. So one is the mobile test automation possibility, and the other one is another automation tool. It's called a coded UA. So here the first session is regarding the mobile test automation, and the tool we are planning to demo here is the tool called APM. Any of you know about APM? Yes or no? Okay, fine. So it's easy for me. Okay, so nowadays, you know, the mobile application is very, very popular, right? We all are having this smartphones, right? Any of you got a normal phone other than smartphone? Can you raise your hand? No. Everybody is using smartphones, right? Oh, that's great. So before starting to the before starting the topics, let me tell you one thing. You know, Forbes recently did a study on the mobile application development and all. So they came to a figure that in 2017, by 2017, the total downloads that's going to happen in the mobile industry is over 270 billion, right? No, we all are daily downloading a lot of applications, right? We all are doing, right? Daily we are downloading a lot of applications. And the main point is that the persons or the people who are using mobile, they are not patient, right? If something is not working, they will throw it away and they will go for the competitive product, right? Daily, I mean, say, if Flipkart is not working, they will go for Amazon. Is not working, we'll go for Snapdeal, right? That's happening. So that is the attitude of the people who are using mobile, right? It's not a fault, okay? Anyway, so the thing is that we need to be very careful about the quality of the product, right? Not only in mobile, but in all the area. Okay, so here now we are going to start with the mobile test automation technique with the help of a tool called APM, okay? So this session contains two part. I mean, the mobile test automation itself contains two part. One is the theory part, and the other one is a demo. Right? I mean, how we can create script, how we can execute, or how we can view the result. So two parts are there. So here, my colleague Sanoop will demonstrate the tool, the script generation part, and I'll take care the other theory part. Okay, so all of you may be knowing the mobile, different type of mobile applications, right? These three terms are very common, right? Hybrid, native, and mobile web. Any idea what is that? Hey, be interactive, and why you are so silent? What is that? Hybrid, native, and web application, mobile web. Any idea? It's not specific Android, right? Hybrid instance, I mean, say it's a kind of combination of two things. I mean, so the hybrid applications, one part we can access through the web, and the other without internet we can access. Say some games or some application, if you take, some part will be applicable or available only through the website or the internet, right? The other one is already available. And the native is the kind of application we have in our mobile, like the calculator or some building kind of applications. And of course, you know the mobile web application. .m, right? You can see that. Most of the sites we can access through the website. I mean, sorry, the mobile devices. Right. So anyway, in the testing, the approach will be almost same, but in mobile testing, we need to be a bit careful about the kind of devices we are testing. You know, daily, a lot of different devices are available in the market, right? People are using different variety of devices. Maybe the resolution will be different, or the size will be different. I mean, a lot of brands are available, right? Okay, so here, normally in testing, the approach is to identify the target devices and OS. Anyway, we cannot test the application in all the possible devices, right? It's too difficult. See, if you're taking the normal web-based application, you can see either you can check in Chrome, or you can check in Firefox, or you can check in IE, or you can check in Mozilla. Anyway, the numbers are limited there. But in the mobile application or the mobile kind of testing, the expected number of devices is very huge, right? You can see a lot of devices from Samsung or a lot of other Chinese mobiles are there, right? So it's difficult to drill down and difficult to find out the number of, I mean, the devices which the end user is going to use. So the first step is to identify the target devices and the OS. Like OS could be either, the Android or the iOS or the Windows, right? That's a popular three OS available, right? Then, either you can use a simulator or you can use a real device. Both we can use, right? But nowadays people are more concerned about the simulators, right? I mean, we have a lot of systems available. A lot of online libraries are available. We can just book for a device online, and we can just get it tested in the real device itself. Don't need to worry about the simulator. Then, deciding the connectivity. I mean, a lot of connectivities are available, 2G, 3G, 4G, a lot of Gs, right? Then, prepare the scenarios. That's common to all the kind of testing, right? We need to find out the scenarios which we are going to test. It's not specific to mobile for all the kind of testing. Then we can decide either we need to go for manual or automation. It's up to you, right? We can decide based on our requirement. If it is a long-term project, we can think about automating the application. Otherwise, if it is only for 1 or 2 weeks, we don't need to worry about the automation, because automation itself may take 1 or 2 weeks to get stable, right? How many of you got experience in automation? One, two, three. I'm always raising my hand. Why you are here? Okay, fine. So that we can decide whether manual or automation depends upon your requirement. Fine. So now, these are the different types of normal mobile application testing. Of course, functionality is very important. Then usability, it's another important feature, right? Another important point, right? I already told you, right? If it is not, if you're feeling it's not usable, we'll throw in, we'll go for another application. Right, Then compatibility. Compatible in different modules, I mean different mobile devices. If it is working properly in iOS, we need to think about the Android, or we need to think about Windows, all the platforms we need to verify. Then security. Think about the banking application and all. The other guy was telling about the banking security things and all. And the interrupt. You know what is interrupt? What will happen if a call is coming in between? If you're testing the application, a call is coming. Or if you're getting a message. Or any other kind of interrupt is coming, how the application is going to behave. That is normally we are checking interrupt. A lot of kind of interrupts we are giving and checking how it is going to react. Then the different networks. Switching between networks. Then, of course, the performance, right? Performance is very important. How the application is responding. It is taking more time. If it is getting crashed or if it is not responding properly, we will go for some other app. Then, installation and installation kind of things. These are the common kind of the types of testing we are conducting in the mobile devices. Okay, shall I go to the next one? Yes or no? So, automating the mobile application. That's a topic, and you can see a lot of devices are available. It's only 6 or 7 is given there, but n number of tools are available there in the market, right? So either we can automate this application in the real devices, or we can think about the simulators. But here now we are going to demonstrate you in the real device, not in the simulator. Okay, and the specialty is that it's OS and device independent script generation. Most of the tools are giving you an option like it's OS or device independent. Same script can be played back or same script can be executed in multiple devices. The change in the OS or the device is not going to affect the script. So you can see a lot of tools like FPM is there, Calabash is there, Monkey Talk is there, Robotium. And most of these tools are open source, and you can see something called as Test Complete or C Test Automation. These tools are paid tool. The advantage is that they are providing you a big or good UI where you can easily generate script. And the installation is also very, very easy. That's a common thing in open source tool, right? In the open source tool, probably the process of setting up things may be a bit lengthy than the other normal kind of paid tools, right? So this is something more about the APM. That specifically I have picked one tool from that list, that is APM. It's an open source test automation, mobile automation tool. And it's actually we can use for native or hybrid or mobile web. All these three are supported by this tool. Then it's suitable for iOS as well as the Android. Both will work. And here we are giving the demo in the Android version. And it's cross-platform, like code written in one OS can be easily used in the other OS. Then it supports Safari on iOS. And normally Chrome or the default browser which is available in the Android device. Right. And it supports multiple languages. The advantage is that this is given a high support of Selenium WebDriver. So whatever the languages you can use in Selenium WebDriver, same thing you can use here also. Right, Java you can use, C Sharp you can use, Ruby you can use, but we are using Java here, right? So we have selected one-to-one language for the demonstration. Okay. So before thinking about installing the APM tool, we should have these kind of things in our mind. Some prerequisites are there. Okay. Android SDK is required for this one, if you're thinking about the Android part. And the Java development kit, JDK, that also required. Then, of course, the Eclipse, that is the IDE we are using, right? Where you can create the scripts. Then the TestNG and some of the plugins are also required, because for the report generation and all, we got some library files. Then APM for Windows or Mac, that also we can download. If you're using the Windows machine, we can download the APM for the Windows. Otherwise, you can go for the Mac version of that APM. Then, APK app info. This particular one need to be installed on the device which we are going to use for testing. I mean, if you're selecting a particular device, that application should be installed there, because we need to collect some important information about the application under test. You may be knowing what is AUT, right? AUT, application under test. So we need to fetch some important information about the AUT using this particular application called APK app info. So that we can install in the real device where we are going to do the automation. Then the Node application, like the one APK app info, these kind of things we need to install. Then the third step is environment variable setup. You may be knowing what is environment variable, right? The system properties, you can set some path and all, right? Yeah. So that's also required for this one. I'll go to that in detail. Then setting the device options, like, I mean, in all the devices, you can see this option like USB debugging enabled. You may be knowing, right? Double tap on a particular win menu from where you can get the USB options. Just enable it, then connect to the device. Just use the USB cable to connect the device, then we can start automating. So this is a link for downloading the APM. Then this is a normal installation procedure. It's like all the other kind of installation application. Just go to the next one. Yeah, 3, 4, 5 steps are there. And finally, so once this the APM is downloaded and installed, you can just think about the setup test environment, the next step, right? So can you see this one? Advanced system testing, settings, right? Where in the advanced tab, you can see the environment variable button. From there, you can see the path, right? Just open the path. Yeah. So you can see add the path of the Android SDK and JDK and Node.js, right? Where these things are installed, you can just get the path. And that you can append here for this particular variable as a value, right? Okay, so that is the environment setup part. Then you can see enabling the developer options. The you can see USB debugging. Just enable it. Then only the these tools will identify this application, whatever you are installing on your real devices. Okay, now these things are ready to connect to the PC. Okay. So this is starting the APM server. Right. So what you can see, can you see this ADB device command there? Can you see this here? ADB devices? Yeah. Once the APM is installed, right, just make sure that the paths are given there in the environment variable. Then you just go to the command prompt and just type this command ADB devices. So what you can see here, list of devices attached. If the device is attached to this particular application or the system, you can get the name of the device. Of course, you can get the name from the mobile itself, but make sure that this is the name that you are going to give in the APM. Use this command ADB devices. So once this command is executed, the APM server will automatically start and you will be getting the name. Please note this name because it's required for the remaining process. Okay. Yeah. So here you can see the Android setting. This is the window of Android. You can see a lot of settings here. You can select the platform name. It's Android, you can select from here. And the automation name is given as APM. Normally, you'll be getting the Selenium also in the dropdown. Select APM in this particular case. Then the platform version, you need to select the platform, the OS, the one you are using, your mobile device. That you can select. And the device name, you can just give the name that you get from the ADB device command. Same thing need to be given there. What difference there in the name given in the real device and this particular? Some cases we can see some hyphen there in the device name which is given there in the real device, but just make sure that the name what you can see in the command, take it and give it. So once these things are completed, you can say that we have completed the setup. Now the system is ready for automating, right? So just we need to make sure that the the applications are installed in the application, the device. That's the only one thing we need to make sure next. Okay, so what you can do is you can just open the Eclipse. Hope you all are familiar with Eclipse. All of you, right? Simply just open the Eclipse and just simply create a project, right? So once the project is created, make sure that these library files are imported, like Selenium, TestNG, and Appium Java client. You can see that in the screenshot. I'll be showing you the screenshot, and while the demo, I'll be just pointing out what are the libraries to be imported. So make sure that these three libraries are imported. And one more thing is the install DDMS plugin. You can just go to the Eclipse and search for the software update. You can see this particular one, DDMS, because this particular plugin is required for identifying the objects in the application. Normally, almost all the automation tools are giving you an option to record and playback. This Appium is also giving that, but it's not properly working in the Windows machines. It's perfectly working in the Mac OS. That is the difference. So we need to tackle that particular issue, and that is the reason why we are installing this DDMS plugin. It's already available during the Eclipse. Just install it. So this particular plugin we can use to get the information about the objects in the application. And what is the next step? Create scripts. So for the script creation also, we have an initial setup. Before starting the scripting, we need to initialize the name of the device, the browser we are using, right? Few things we need to set that I'll show you. That is called as the initial setup, and it's only for one time. Once this is set, we can make it as a function, and wherever required, we can reuse it. Right, then identify the objects using Appium or the Eclipse DDMS plugin. This is what I said. Normally, if you're using Appium in Mac OS, you can use the built-in mechanism to identify the object. Otherwise, we need to think about this particular plugin called as DDMS. Right, that's why we installed this DDMS prior to the script generation. Then create functions in the specified library file. You can think about your own, right? Then add the object's properties to an Excel or property file. You are having experience in automation, right? Generally, let me tell you one thing. Normally, the automation tools are identifying an object with the help of a set of properties. When we're doing the manual testing, we can see the application, we can click on a save button, or we can click on a file menu, or we can click on a cancel button or OK button. We can see the object and we can perform the user actions, right? But when we are doing the automation, how the automation tools are identifying the objects? The tools cannot see whether it's OK or whether it's a menu or whether it's a cancel or whether it's a save button, right? With the help of some properties, right, these tools are identifying the object. So that properties we can capture, and that we can give either in a Java property file or in an Excel file. You know, the thing is that it's easy for us to maintain it. When there is a small change happened, we just want to change only in one area, not in all the scripts. Just imagine you have a script which contains the OK button click, and you create another script, and you again create another script. Say if three or four scripts are created with the same object, and one day the developer is changing that OK to save or proceed, you need to change in all the places, right? To avoid that, what you can do, you can think about this common file, right? Either you can use an Excel or you can use a property file. Then, normally these are the properties commonly Appium using to identify the object or the objects in the application. You can see the ID, the very commonly used property, and XPath, or the class name, or the link text. Say, if you take an example of a save button, probably save is the link text, right? Or the OK will be the link text. So that properties you can take to identify the object. Of course, it all depends upon the kind of application you're using. It may vary from the normal hybrid application to the mobile web application. It depends upon the kind of application. You can decide what all properties are uniquely required to identify the object, take it. You have the flexibility, right? Then create the scripts by arranging the function in a logical order. And you can create a lot of functions, right? Say for login, you can create a function. For adding an object or adding a particular item to the shopping cart, you can create a function. For the checkout, you can create another function. For the payment method, you can create another function. And finally, you can just call all these things in the specific order to make it as a single test case, right? Then create a test suite by calling individual scripts in the logical order. Say, just think about the smoke testing, or just think about the regression testing. You don't need to execute the all test cases, right? A number of test cases, we need to select and execute it. Similar way, here also, if you have all the set of test cases or scripts available, just call that in the logical order, just execute as a single shot, right? Okay, so this is called as a initial setting. I told you in the previous slide, right? Some initial settings need to be done. It's only a one-time activity. Can you see something here? It's called as describing the capabilities, right? To identify that device, we need to set some capabilities in terms of APM. So here, what we are doing, we are setting the device name. The name what I got from the APK, the ADB command, right? Just give the name, and what is that? The browser name. Actually, Selenium is identifying all these things as browsers. That is why this keyword is given, browser, and the value is Android. So what is that? The version, like Android version 5.1.1. Of course, the platform is Android, and you can see the app package. From where you got this? In India? Can you get it from the application? Here we can use the one I told you, right? APK app info. This need to be installed in the device, right? So what you can do, I'll just demonstrate that how to get this information from the application. Just open that application. You can see all these names, right? The package name, source directory, everything you can see there. That information need to be given here. The package details, right? Got it. So this is called as the initial setup. Once this is done, we can keep it as a function, and wherever required, we can reuse it. It's a one-time effort. Okay. So I told you, right, this APM has got two modes of object identification. It has got a built-in inspector, APM inspector. It's called as APM inspector. How many of you know about QTP or UFT? Any idea about UFT? No. Anybody have idea about RFT? Don't worry. Okay, so in QTP, this kind of option is called as SPI, object SPI. Similarly, here in APM, it's called as APM inspector. This is that tool we are using to identify the object properties, the menu or the button or the edit box or the drop-down, whatever it is. This particular option can be used to identify the object properties. So normally, this is more suitable for the iOS. It's properly working only in the iOS. Probably it's a kind of limitation. It's working in the Windows also, but it's not that much effective. We cannot get all the properties using this APM inspector. That is the reason why we are going for the second method for the Windows specific OS DDMS plugin, the one I told. So if you're installing that, you can use that this plugin to select a particular object in that application, and the property will be displayed here. Once the environment is set up, when you are connecting the device, the device screen will be displayed here. And the application also opened here. You can see each and every object here. When you're selecting, when you're dragging and dropping on a particular object, you can see the different properties, right? Index, text, class, package. A lot of properties you can see here. From this set of property, just take the unique one to identify that object, then proceed to the scripting, right? So this is the normal kind of a script created, where you can see it's a kind of functional specific, the application specific function I created. What is that? We are clicking on a particular menu, and we are sending some keys. So these kind of scripts you can create based on the test case what you have. You'll be having a set of test cases which we can automate, right? Don't think that we can automate all the test cases, right? We need to check the feasibility, whether it is automatable or not. So if you get a set of test cases which is automatable, try to create the reusable functions, right? And so once these reusable functions are created, we can call this test case in a different Java file. You can see that, right? Any name you can give, okay? So just call that particular one, navigate to account page, one function, and some create expense. You can see create expense function is created, and that I'm calling here. So it's a sequential execution of functions, right? Okay, so previously I told you about the property file, right? Am I going so fast? It's a very small duration session, right? I need to cover a few more points. Is it okay? Are you able to get these points? Right? Okay. Anyway, we have some question and answer session after this, right? Discuss something. So this is called as a property file. I told you, right, in the previous slide, right? When we are capturing the objects, the properties need to be given in a particular file that is called as property file. Can you see a lot of variables defined here? Var underscore action bar, var underscore push button. So these are the objects I captured from that application. And the properties are given inside the variable in this particular file. That's called var.properties. The name I given, okay, you can give your own name. This is one method. Otherwise, you can think about an Excel sheet where you can go for the, I mean, these variables and the values also you can give there. Okay, then what is this? This is called as test suite. We already discussed, right? Either we can run the entire test as a smoke suite, or we can go for a regression test cases where all these test cases are called in a particular sequence. You can see that execution script dot tc underscore 001. This is the name I given there. And the other one is tc underscore 002. You can just create how many test cases you want, make it as a suite, just run it. Right? When a regression test case is, regression is going to happen, you can just run this set of suite of test cases. Okay. So this is the execution level. So initially we did the setup, the environment setup, the prerequisites for this particular application. Then we did the initial script setup. Then we identify the test cases, we created the script, and finally we are going to execute it. What is that? So we need to verify the app, so IPM server is up and running. That's the first thing. We need to make sure that things are working properly. I mean, the app server should be up and running. Then open the project and select the script. In that Eclipse, you can just open the project that we created with that test cases. Select the particular test you want to run, then execute the test against AUT. AUT means the application under test, the application against which we are going to execute the application. Then analyze the result, whether it is pass or fail, right? That you can decide. Whether if it is a pass or fail, we can just raise the defect or leave it. So this is a result file you can see there. If possible, you can think about more other plugins and modify the result into different formats. And if possible, we can send this result to other members as well using the continuous integration method. Right. Okay. So, of course, all these tools has got some advantages as well as disadvantages, right? So these are some of the advantages and disadvantages of this particular tool. Like the advantage is that it's open source. Anybody can use it, no license issue. And cross-platform. Can create a script in one platform, can port that into other platform, like the script created in iOS can be used in Windows or in Android. There's no dependency between the platform. Then support iOS and Android, so very, very commonly or the popular available OS. Then Selenium WebDriver compatible. How many of you know about Selenium? How many of you use that? So you may be knowing the importance of Selenium compatibility, right? A lot of things you can get from the Selenium. many methods that is available in Selenium can be reused here as well. Then support hybrid native and mobile web application. Three types of mobile applications are supported by this particular tool. And the main limitation is that limited support for the older version of Android. Currently we are in the 5.1 version, right? Is it 5.1 or 5.7? Okay. So the older version, they are not giving much support. And built-in object identification mechanism, I told you, right? That is not properly supporting in the Windows OS. If you are in the iOS, if you are in the Mac OS, it's properly working. That is one limitation. Then limited support on hybrid application. We cannot easily identify all the properties of an hybrid application using APM. But we need to find out some workaround for that in the real, real scenarios. Then device need to be active at the time of execution. The device should not get locked. If it is getting locked, probably the script execution may fail. That we need to make sure. Right. So we cannot leave the device there without setting that option. Then initial configuration is a bit lengthy process. I just explained all these things in two slides, but the configuration part is a bit complex one, like a lot of prerequisites are there. If everything is available, then no issue. Java is available, if Eclipse is available, if the other plugins are available, then no issue. Otherwise, we need to start from the very beginning. Right, a lot of things you see in the other slide, right? So the initial configuration is a bit lengthy process. That can be considered as a disadvantage. These disadvantages are when you're comparing with the paid application, then only we can consider these things as disadvantages. Otherwise, not a big issue. So can we have a quick demo on that? Right? Just a script creation, just an execution. Can we have it? Yes or no? Fine. So here's my colleague Sanoop. He will just go through the application. Can you just open it? Anyways. Yeah, maximize it. See, you can see here, this is the Eclipse, the interface. You can see, Sanoop, can you just point out the library files which are required to import? You can see the reference library files. What else? Anything else to be imported? The test ng required, right? Can you just, fine. Come down. Test ng is also required, right? So these are the library files to be imported. Go to the top. So this is one framework structure we created, where you can see some library files and one package for keeping the test cases. And can you take the other property file? Yeah, where we have defined a lot of variables. So when you are progressing with your test cases, you'll be getting increase. So when there is a change in the UA, or when there's a change in the property of any of the object, just in one place we need to change. Wherever you are using this variable, getting updated. Can you just close that too? Can you just open the APM? Okay. Kill this one and go to the area. Possible to in the application. So this is that application, the APK info. You can see a lot of application installed in this particular device. Can you select that? When we are going to demo. Come down. Yeah. So this is an application we installed in our machine, and this is the one we are going to use for the demonstration. When you click on that, you can see the details, right? Package name, the details and all. Just click on some other application, there also you can see it, right? Any other application, you can just see the package, source, everything you can see there. So this is the APK app info, right? Okay, now you just open this, run the Selenium, APM. To show demo here. Actually, we are using a supporting software to display the things what is happening in the mobile. Okay, same thing is going to work here also, but it's difficult for us to demo to you. So we are using another supporting software to display that. Yeah. So. Exactly. No, she's asking about this particular application. This one, this part. Otherwise, it's difficult for us to demo here with this particular device, right? Okay. Can we keep here? So now the APM, the server is up and running. Oh, you're going to, right? Okay. Can we have that mic, the other one? Thank you. If prepared. Now it's up and running. So, Sanup, can you just demo with one script creation? Yeah. Just take a new script.
I'm doing is I'm going to make a new class, then I'll make a test script.
This is already there, right?
Yeah. It is.
So this is the initial setup, what I told, right? The initially we need to set something.
Exactly same as last you.
Either you can call this as a function or you can just paste it wherever you, I mean, whatever the test case you are creating. Both way it will work.
So now we have to click here.
So that is a DDMS plugin what we told, right?
We have to open the application under test, and I'm using
scrolling the second page.
And
this is a sample application we are using here for the demonstration. It's an expense manager. It's already available on the Android that store, right? The Play Store, it's already available. We have taken one application as a sample.
We are identifying objects. I'll show you.
So just click on that plugin. You can see the screen what we have taken in the device in that particular window. So when you're dragging your mouse, you can see a red square, you can see the right, that is the object highlighting. So when you are highlighting the object, you can see the properties here. So Sanip, can just hover your mouse to other devices, I mean other objects. You can see a lot of properties here, right? So from here we need to get the exact or the unique property, then that we can use for automating it.
here. So I am taking its ID.
So just copy the data. Can just come in the other one.
Sorry.
No.
One minute.
Please make sure the other required packages are imported. So here we are trying to find out that object with the properties, what we got from that plugin. What happened? Just give me 1 minute. Can you see this or should I increase the font? Sure. Let me try to increase the font. Actually, I didn't try that.
Let's have a break for about 5 minutes, and the tea will be served to you. Sorry, it's coffee. For the time being, let us get engaged with a few QC time. And I have few questions with me. I'll be asking the questions. And the person who know the answer may raise your hands. And the person who tells the correct answer will get FAYA goodies. Okay? Let me start. Okay, already know? So the first question. Everybody will be knowing that Apple have several code names for their projects. During 2004, they started a secret project before the launch of iPhones. What was the code name for that secret project? Don't search in your phones, please. Do I need to repeat the question? Repeat, okay. What is the code name for the secret project before the launch of iPhone? Okay, iPhone, that was the project for the launch of iPhone and building of iPhone. So they have a secret code for it. What is that name? No idea? So I'll give a clue. It's a color. Yeah? No, I can't hear you. Swift? No, not that. It's not the right answer. That's a color. Please raise your hand so that I could hear. No, that's not the right answer. Give a guess. No, I said it's a color. No, yeah. No, that is not violet. No, everybody's starting to tell all the colors. Okay. Yeah? No, yellow is not the answer. Yeah, that's the answer. It's So let me know your name and from which company you're coming from.
I'm Suji from Tata Alexi.
Okay, so Suji is getting this FAYA goodie. Congrats. So let's move with the next question. Okay, the next question. The official mascot for Linux kernel. Hope everybody know that. What is that? Official mascot for Linux kernel. What is the name of that? You can see it. Everybody might have noticed it. Just think of. It's a penguin. What is the name? I can't hear you. Somebody giving an answer? No. Give a guess. No. Yeah. That is the right answer. It's tux. So could tux, T-U-X.
I am Dilip. Hi. I am from Somnavar.
Congrats, Dilip. Please give a big round of applause. No, he gets the prize. So I'll move on to the last and final question. Hope somebody give answer for this too. Okay. That's a new accessory that was developed in Surface Studio. Okay, there's a new accessory that was developed with Surface Studio. That is actually for creative professionals, that supports the work of creative professionals. What's that accessory? Yeah, that's the answer. It's Surface Rail. It was so fast. Your name, please.
Yeah, I'm Naveen. I'm a freelance Android developer.
Congrats. Give a hand, please. Okay, let's see a video of Surface Dial. And it's a small accessory, but it gives wonder. Thing is that Surface Dial. Let's see what it does. Surface Dial. That definitely is a beautiful innovation, no? Yeah. For more explanations, I guess he's the right person to tell.
So surface dial is a contextual accessory which is supposed to use for the, I mean, used by the creative professionals. So you can place it on the surface screen, and based on the app, it shows the quick menus so that, for example, you have seen a color dial, right? So you can use both of your hands and control them simultaneously, right? So typically when you work with Photoshop, you click something, then you draw, right? So you can use both of your hands and control certain parameters. So in the demo, you have seen the color changes as you draw on the pen. So some similar type of a creative work can be achieved using surface. And with maps, if you have maps, then you can use it for rotating the map, zooming, panning, those kind of stuff. So that's basically with the surface. So it's basically a contextual device, something I would say similar to what you have seen with the MacBook Pro with the touch bar strip. So it is also a contextual device. So based on the app, it shows what exactly it is. I mean, different type of buttons, like if it is on mail, then you can see a trash button, send reply. If you get a phone call, then it shows whether you want to attend the call or decline the call. So those kind of things. So it's a contextual accessory. But dial is the interactive mode. So the programmers can configure it. So already products like Photoshop already making use of these features. So yeah, so it depends on the apps, how the surface dial should be used. Right.
Thank you for the beautiful explanation. So now let's continue the session. Please, sir.
Is it readable now? Back? So here we are using the keyword find element by the ID. ID is the property we have taken from that application. And the ID is given the com dot, yeah. This is one we copied from here. We are given here, and finally we are given the method, like click or edit or whatever the method we are planning to do on that particular object. Just click, then.
Then we have to move to the next page. So that we have to do manually now.
Yeah, this is the script creation part. Here we need to do it manually. Then only we can automate it, right?
No. Now we have to do this again. Like we have to open DDMS again.
If it's in the same page, we can get it right. But here we are going to the next page. So from the, we need to get it from the beginning, like as the object is in the different page.
You want to click here, then you have to use this ID.
No, the other one. Sorry. No. Fine. Just proceed. So similarly, here we can create the script by getting the IDs or the unique property, then do the scripting using the that particular component. So can you just open one of the existing script? It's taking more time to create the script, right?
The Selenium web driver, just like click or send keys that you can give. It's exactly the same.
Just take one of the test case what you created. Yeah. Can you explain the purpose of this particular test case?
It's for creating a new expense Actually, the application I'm using is a kind of expense manager. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new expense. So let's start.
Also, right?
Yeah.
So this particular test case contains three functions. One is navigate to the account page, then another function for creating an expense, then we are just verifying it. That particular expense is created or not.
I'm using test-ng here. Actually, this initialization and all, I have used like this before suit. So can be run all the time before running a test. So also after suit, the driver will be closed, just like that.
Just execute the test case. Just select the test case. No, it's not running. It's disconnected. Can you just connect again? Probably when I take this here, it got disconnected. Can you just kill this? Can you kill that one and open again? So also you can see in the mobile device, the application is opened. And we are just adding a new expense. A new expense added here. So here also you can see in the device. So here you can see the assessment, the result.
Yeah, it took.
This is the time taken.
Also, you can see this result.
It's a different perspective. Can you just execute the other one also? We have created one more test case for the demo. Can you explain that? What is that?
Actually, this is how we are creating payment method. Actually, some default payment.
This is an application component. In this application, we have something called as payment method. We can create our own payment method. This is how we are identifying the scenarios, right, for the real automation. So here also we identify two scenarios and we try to create the script for that. Just execute it. No, say the same thing. Oh, no. Fine.
we are adding a new payment method called debit card. That's it. Is also passed. That's it.
So normally, after creating the test cases, we can insert whatever the validations required. Like, I mean, here in this case, what we validate is like whether the new entry is created or not. So similar to your test case, you can just create the scripts here, and you can run it as a read. Right. So that's a simple demo we planned for this particular tool. So we have one more session pending, so any question or anything to be discussed? Probably to you.
Hello?
Yeah, sorry.
You'll be giving app name and package name and activity name, right? Okay. So using APK info, we'll be identifying the package name and also the activity name. But but activities name, we will be having a list of activities. So how will you identify the correct activity? Anyone
from that list? That is why we are using this application to get all the possible details.
Okay. Anything
from that list? Which one? Are we executing this in jar file or simply the script creation? Not the jar, right? Actually, we implement this only for the simple script execution, not for the jar. We didn't try this as a jar, actually. I got it. I mean, in normal cases, we can think about some external files like XML and all. But in the jar file, let me just check and come back on this. I got the question what you asked. Normally that is possible. Normally that's let me just check and come back on this particular one. Yeah, I'll just note the question. No. Which one? It's required. Yeah, it's required. Then we can identify the particular device, right? Okay. Anyway, we will check on this particular one and come back. Sure. Please note the question, okay. Can I have your email ID after this?
Can you show on test case failed?
Sorry? We just created only two test cases for the demo. And we need to, anyway, the application is properly working, right? So we didn't create any other negative flow for this. If you're giving us our mail ID, you can just, we will send you one scenario with this failed one. You can just, if APM is already there in your machine, you can just execute that. Because this application is properly working, right? So we don't have a negative scenario. We don't have a scenario where the application expectation is different, and that we didn't try actually in this particular, for this particular demo. It's possible. If it is not working properly, you'll get a failed result.
Compatible with Android Studio.
Sorry?
Android Studio.
Eclipse, right?
For the IDE. This particular, yeah. For the Mac Windows, right?
It's only for Windows.
Not for the Mac. For this particular one, you can just in two IPM server need to be opened, right?
We can start another IPM server on some other phone.
Make sure that that's not used any other part.
I have to mention it in the script.
Depends upon the. And again, be frank, there's some issue with the IPM. Like, I mean, if the number of devices getting increased, it's getting hanged. We experienced that also. Yeah. We tried three only, not more than that. Yeah, exactly. Selenium grid is required, fine, right? That's a common approach, No. Difficult. Sorry? Understand. That scenario, we need to create and simulate it, right? Finally, I mean, when you're working the application, we are expecting something, right? If an interrupt is coming, of course, the script should fail. I mean, if the application is not working properly. Otherwise, if we have the expectation that we can just get it in the script. Yeah, exactly. Sorry. Like some calls coming, all right? Did you try that on? No, we didn't try it actually. Actually, we are trying this in the normal devices where there's no SIM given or that kind of things is not. I mean, we just tried only the functional part, not the other areas. Only the functionality we just covered through this automation.
Which one? Say that you are running this this test. Okay, now if I want to take a contact, just take a contact and whether this will run in the background.
No.
It has to be, I mean.
Yeah, that's why the log is a big problem, right?
Running this script in the background, is it possible?
No.
The UI elements.
No, UI elements are by the ID, no?
Yeah.
So do you think that is compulsory for the UI to come up and stand?
It's up
like
and running, right? So it should up and running. Yeah.
But is it possible?
No, it should up and running. Same issue we face with the other tools, right? The coded UI also, right? I mean, the coded UI also, the script should up and running. I mean, the UI should up and running, right? It's
testing suits best for this APM, like smoke testing regression or all types of.
Normally, we used to go for the smoke and regression, right? Not into much detail. I mean, the thing is that actually these tools are also getting evolved. I mean, day by day, a lot of features are there adding. So we tried actually for the normal smoke and regression testing. No, not much into detail.
Yeah.
So that we use the commands as well. Right?
Okay. How can we get the URL?
Which one?
There is an URL.
Which one?
Yeah, that you are.
Yeah, it is same as this.
While we are configuring, we will get an.
Yeah.
By default, it's coming, right?
Coming through this port, 4723.
for Windows and I think 8080 for Mac, I think. So it's configured through localhost through this port. So we are using that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. The same script we can port in the other one.
Yeah.
No. The other parts is fine. I mean, the functional part is fine. Yeah, the functional part we can reuse wherever is required.
The thing is like iOS devices need some library files to run, I think. Just like this USB debugging mode, it should be connected to macOS for taking full control. So macOS is required. It will not work in Windows.
She's asking about the other setup also. That also required, I mean, need to change. But the functional part, we can reuse it. Yeah, it's possible. But the thing is, actually, there's some limitation in identifying the objects. Not for all the objects, but some objects is difficult to use the APM, it's difficult to get it. But, I mean, if in the real case, we need to find out some workaround for that. I mean, some keystroke or something we need to find out in the real examples, I mean, real cases. Fine? No. Actually, our project, we are running only in the, Android versions. In two projects, we tried the same thing, and iOS, we didn't try that actually in the real scenarios. Of course. The same thing what we are doing in Selenium as well, right?
Our workspace, that HTML file.
Can we able to share this?
Yeah, sure. Just like here I am using TestNG. So the report coming is
in this particular format.
Either I can use some third party tool, ReportNG or something.
And you'll be getting some more good report, and from the, I mean, you need to check for the other continuous generation to get it export to other one. It's not actually a part of, I mean, APM. Get the result, then we can send it.
No, it's not that.
John? The other question I'll share the my mail ID. You can just shoot a mail to me. I'll just reply to that back. Shall we go to the next topic? Thank you. Just come to the other one. Got it? Basically, you can sit here. So, normally in this kind of sessions, we used to go for the open source tool, but here, this is a small change. Like, I mean, it's a kind of paid tool we are going to demonstrate here. And before that, I'd like to know one thing. I mean, how many of you are using Microsoft platform? Visual Studio? A few of are using, right? Okay. So in normally automation, the main difficulty or the main challenge we are facing is the kind of application we are going to test. If it is a web-based application, there are a lot of tools available, right? Selenium is the best tool, right? It's very easy to automate the automate using Selenium. But in the case of the other applications like desktop application, how to automate using an open source tool? The big question. It's difficult to find out a good automation tool for the desktop application. But here, what we can do is that along with the Microsoft Visual Studio, we have a small tool called as Coded UI. How many of you know that? Coded UI. Along with, many people are using Microsoft platform, right? And they are working with the desktop application as well. So how to automate that desktop application is a big question. So for that, along with the Microsoft Visual Studio, they are providing a tool called as Coded UI. So we are just going to demonstrate a small scenario with the help of this tool, Coded UI, to automate the desktop application. How many of you are working with the desktop application? Do you automate that? No. If you have this platform, you can just think about that also. Of course. Is it 2015? 13. 13 is professional, right? 13, professional. Ultimate, right? Ultimate. Right. You can just. Anyway, this part we don't cover. I mean, functional automation. We already discussed a lot of points regarding this, right? So, normally, in Visual Studio, we have a tool called as Microsoft Test Manager for the manual testing purpose. You can create scripts. You can execute this as a manual test cases. And for the unit testing, anyway, one unit testing component is there in Visual Studio. And for the functional automation, this is a tool called as Coded UI, which is coming along with the Visual Studio. In 2015, it's coming along with the Enterprise Edition. And for the other 2013, it's coming along with the Ultimate. And for the performance also, we have a component called as Web Performance and Law Test. So here, the demo is for the functional automation tool as Coded UI. So anyway, the Coded UI is normally the tool from the Microsoft, and it comes along with Visual Studio Enterprise version of 2015 and the Ultimate and Premium of 2013. And actually, this is using the Visual Studio IDE itself to create the test cases or the scripts. Don't need to go for any other IDE. And normally, it's using two languages, either VB or you can use the C# as a programming language for creating scripts. Then this can be integrated with any other ALM, like, I mean, application lifecycle management, right? Any continuous integration also, you can just integrate these scripts. Then actually, this supports the desktop, then Windows Mobile. It's very rarely used, but still Windows Mobile we can use, web service or web application, all these kind of things we can automate with the help of this Coded UI. And can execute tests in more remote machines. For that, we require something called as test agent as well. That also coming along with the Visual Studio. Right. So probably, I mean, those who are familiar with the Visual Studio, this window is also familiar, right? Creating a new project. So simply, if the Coded UI is also available there, you can see a Coded UI template there. Just give a name and create a new project. So this is the normal Coded UI interface. It's similar to the Visual Studio, right? So here you can see the scripts created. We will explain that with an example. So normally in Coded UI, when we are creating a new script, we have two mechanisms or two methods to create a script. Just like all the other tools, this Coded UI is also giving an option to record and playback. But in most of the cases, recording playback is not going to work properly. Right? A lot of dynamism will be there in the object. So we have one more option called as simple hand coding. So both options are available. One is the Coded UI record and playback mode. You can see here the red red dot. Using this, we can just create some scripts by simply doing the recording. Or otherwise, you can just create using the simple hand coding. Okay. So I hope you remember the APM, that inspector, right? Similarly, here also, you can see one thing called as coded UI test builder. Using this option here, you have an option to capture the object properties. You can see a lot of properties, control type, technology name, help text, class name, friendly name, a lot of names you can see here. Using this, the test builder, you can get the properties from the application that you're going to test, then create the script. So this is a script creation method. As I told, there are two methods. One is the record and playback, and the other one is the hand coding. So here what you can do is you can just create or open an existing or a new coded UI project, just like what I shown in the other slide. Then right click on that test method. When you're opening a new coded UI project, you can see a page like here. From there, you just right click. You'll be having an option to record it, right? Then record the scenario that you want to automate. Then insert the required verification points. Then pause the recording and you can see script generator. Don't go for stop. After recording all the required steps, just pause the script and go for this particular option, script generator. You'll be getting the script created. We will demo that. So normally the coded UI has got four parts. One is called as the coded UI test.cs file. That is the file contains the main test method, like the test you are going to create. I mean the test case you are going to create will be coming in this particular coded UI test.cs file. I'll show you in the demo. Then we have another file called as uimap.uitest. This is actually an XML file which is generated automatically when you're doing the recording. It actually contains the hierarchy of the objects you are capturing as a part of recording. Don't need to edit it actually. Then uimap.cs file. Of course, this is a blank file which is automatically recording when you're doing the script generation. Here you have the flexibility to add your own code, your own custom codes. I told you, right, we cannot completely go for the record and playback. So sometimes we need to create our own functions or our own methods. So that you can just insert into this particular uimap.cs file. Then uimap.designer.cs file. This is also an auto-generated file that contains the code and the properties. I told you, right, we have some option to capture the properties of an object. So that property will be captured in this uimap.designer file. So normally when you created a script, of course, we can go to the build menu. You can clean the solution if a build is already existing. Otherwise, build a complete solution. Then select, can you see some methods here? This is specialty of coded UI. You cannot see this particular one in the normal Visual Studio. If the project is created in coded UI, you can see this method. These are the test cases I created as a part of either recording or the hand coding. You can see two different test cases I created. You can just select the test that you want to run, or you can just go for the run all method, which will run all the test cases coming in this particular solution. Then, select the method, then click on the run button, and then you can analyze the result after the execution, right? So by default, coded UI is giving you a log file which contains the name of the test case which passed and some details as well. But this is very high level kind of result, right? You cannot see the, each and every step in this particular result file. So there is a small method we can follow to get a detailed report. That is, if you have the coded UI or if you have the Visual Studio installed in your machine, you can just go to this location, see program files, that particular location, where you can see a Qt agent 32.exe. So that file, if you edit it, you can see you 0 for off, no report, 1 for errors, 2 for warning, 3 for just information, 4 for all the things. So if your result contain all this information, go for this option 4, you'll be getting a very detailed report. And one more thing you have to set here, enable snapshot information. Make it as true. Like when you're executing the test cases, for each and every step, one screenshot will be captured, and that also you can see in the result file. So for that, we need to edit this particular file, then save it. Otherwise, we can just go for the built-in result. It's a simple one. Yeah, here you can see step-by-step result you can see here. And for each step, you can see the screenshot as well. This we are getting only because we have edited that Qt32 file. And we given the value as 4. For all the kind of information as well as the pass file, you'll be getting the step-by-step information. And we have enabled that screenshot capturing as on. I mean, true. That is why we are getting, for each and every step, you're getting the screenshot. So this is a simple tool. We will just demonstrate you how to create a new script. Shall I? So there's not much setup here we need to do. Anyway, we have the Visual Studio already installed here. So can I just create a new script? I mean, new project also for them? Just a project creation. Then we'll go to the existing project.
I am going for creating a new project.
Zone. No, it's not.
Hello?
Yeah.
First go to the file and you go to new and select project. You can see various types of projects. And this one is coded UI. Select the coded
UI. This is available only if this version is the one we told. I mean, if it is 2015, it's already coming with the enterprise version. Otherwise, we need to go for the ultimate or personal, right?
Coded UI is available for Visual Basic, you know.
And the C#.
And for C#, there is one. And all the others are not supported coded UI. And we are here mainly using C#. So select the coded UI project. Select a project name, click OK. And a window will pop up.
Yeah, this is the one I told. I mean, we have some option to record the scenarios, what you want to automate.
Choose two of any options. The first option is that if we want to record, use this option, otherwise use an existing recording.
Just cancel it and you go to the already created project where you can see the other scripts.
Created one project.
Can you just expand this solution explorer part, right side? Yeah. So here you can see the different library files we created. Here we have only created one library, that's application as you want. If you have multiple modules in your application, you can create corresponding files here. And we have one more folder called as the common and the element definition. Can I just open any of this file, the common and elements? Can you take any one of the, one of the function and explain it?
This is like normal object-oriented programming. We have a class and all the functions are written inside the class.
Exactly. For some reasons, this common name itself means the functions we are commonly used all over your project can be considered as a common function. Like here, the one we created is random string generator, probably for the test data management. We may require a random data for all the test execution. So a random string generator function we are defined here.
there are other other functions also, like a random number generator. If we want to generate an alphanumeric, and if we want to write some.
In some cases, we may require the data or the test data to be written into an external file for the future use. For that, we have created a function here that we named as file writer something, right? It's our own function, common function we created for some other project. And go to the element definition, yeah. So similar to the other property file, here we have this element definition.cs file for storing all the objects. Here we have defined. Can you just scroll down and show them some variables we defined here. So from this file we are using this variable to create the other scripts. Can you take one of the script we created? Or before that, can you just create a simple script with any of this application? A simple script generation using the record method? Sure.
Would I just create new project or?
No, the other one you create, you can use. We create a sample project here, right? That also you can use if required. Otherwise, you just go for the same thing. No issue. The file open. So this is the coded UA test. This is the main class. Here we are going to create a new test.
As we all already said, if we have to spy on an object, we have to right click on the test method, generate code for coded UA test, and use coded UA test builder. And the coded UA test builder will come up.
Can you see this one? Start recording.
That if I just opening my Thunderbird.
We are opening a desktop application, not the web.
And I am starting the recording. And every action I am doing in Thunderbird should got recorded in the coded UA. And so.
That's fine. Okay. So once the recording is completed for your scenario, you just pause that recording. Yeah, just close that. I mean, Thunderbird got it. Yeah, correct. Yeah, that is a generate code option.
Method name here.
So it's better to give a name corresponding to your functionality. Just give a name.
Okay, you can see that the method has come up in here. And if we go UI map and UI map designer, the all the recorded steps are described in UI map designer. And if we want to add some, we can modify. We can add in this partial class, which is similar to
this designer.
Add the step if we want something.
The custom code you are supposed to add only to the UI map, not to the other one.
Shall we run it?
Just right click and go to the test method. Just right click here, go to the test method definition, you can see the content.
This is the test method.
Okay, fine. So this is how we can create the script. Otherwise, we have the hand code method. Anyway, we have created some scripts for the demonstration. Can you open the other one? And just explain the scenario as well. Demo one, right?
The scenario is that to validate a mail is sent from one account to the recipient account. So we have encoded this all the steps in the test method.
Here the recording is not used.
Any recording?
So can you explain that? Yeah. Just explain that also.
So.
This is a method, right? Send mail.
Send mail. This method is defined in the application.cs. This one does is it take the from address and to address and with subject and the content and all filled in the necessary fields and click the send and wait it until the message is delivered, and after that we go to the send item or send items and validate that the reached mail is sent, and after that we go to the
other users inbox and verifying whether the email which we sent from the other account is present or not. Can you just do the playback? So just build,
this one is a previous build, and I am just
this one I told. I mean, we have some test name will be coming here. And just build it.
And I am running
Either you can run from here or you can run from here. Both options are there. Just right click on the particular method you want to run. Just right click, run it, or just from here run it. Run a single script or multiple scripts.
As we said, it opened the write message window. And selecting the from address.
Delay from the Thunderbolt side, right?
Oh.
Slow. The two address is given. These values are parameters and passed to that particular function we created, send mail.
I have used that alphanumeric function, that's why the subject and content.
Yeah, the random string generation, you remember that function we already created. Same thing we use here, otherwise, when in this case it's fine, otherwise if duplication comes, some scenario may fail. sound right? What happened? Can you just run again? The part of the demo, something wrong. Verification, right?
So it's gone to the send mail, and we are searching the subject, and now it's validating. After that, the second mail ID I have attached in this Thunderbird itself.
Both mail IDs are given here, configured here. Now we are going to the inbox of the other mail and searching for this one. So here also, this random value, if you are writing to your file, we can reuse it.
You can see that the test is passed.
Just open the normal result.
The test explorer, this one is the normal default result viewer. And we can, if we have any something to print, we can use this output window.
There you can just write whatever you required in the dynamic phase. Just open the other. As in this particular one, we just configured that file, T32 file. So that is the reason why we're getting this attached file with the details of the execution.
UI test action log. So you can see that the every step here and its screenshot.
So the current selection also I highlighted there. So if any failure happened, you can just get the information from the screenshot itself.
And this is the location. This one is the location of the file. Thank you.
That's all right. So that's all the demo. So as I said, if we have the Visual Studio available in our environment, we can just think of this particular tool called UA, because it's already coming along with that tool. We don't need to go and buy another tool. And again, it's a solution for the desktop application. I mean, automating the desktop application, because that's a pain area we are facing, right? So any questions in this area? Yeah, it just pauses.
So, if a desktop application is using multiple DLLs and all, so can we use this coded UI to that type of applications?
No. She was asking about, I mean, how the application already opened when you run the script. Can you just open that? Let's go to the definition.
There was a recording happening. What will happen? Some other window pops up in between.
Which one?
And what will happen if another window pops up in between?
No, if you're clicking on that, then only it's getting recorded, right?
No. Recording that Thunderbird. No, but accidentally, some other window popped up in between. So does that go into the recording or what happens?
If you click on that, then only it's getting recorded.
So just because it came into focus, it will not get recorded.
No, you can just pause it and close the window and then continue with that. Just pause the recording, close the pop-up window, then continue the recording. But the execution may affect, I mean, if some pop-up window comes. But that also we can handle with the help of some pop-up window handling. Have you used QTP? And this question is, I mean, something connected to QTP, that's why I asked. Okay, no problem.
Is there any option to pose the test result to a tool? I mean, like Jira?
Sorry?
Pose the test result?
No, directly we don't have.
Complete, we can pose the issue to Jira directly.
No, this is not possible. I mean, this particular one contains another test management called as Microsoft Test Manager. So from here directly we can pose that defect to the test manager, not to the external tool. Sorry? No. And the other tools if you're using, yeah.
Do that. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. It's an example of what you're getting, right? No, we don't have. Currently, we don't have. Again, for that, we need to start from the build itself, right? Normally, that's taken by the development team, not by the testing team in our scenarios. We used to create the scripts and hand over to the team. They will. Any more questions? So thank you. Sure. Sorry, did you see that coded UA builder? I mean, when you're recording it, a small window will be coming. Just take the recorder. Yeah, just show how it is opening. Just drag and select the object using that particular one. Can you select some other object? I mean, just drag and select. I can just go to the parent also after the drop. Yeah, just go to that. Did you see that option? Using that option, we can go to the parent level as well from the bottom. So we can get the value from there, we can just hand code it. Can I just give them, no, the email ID. So I mean, the question you can just show to this mail ID. I'll just reply to that. Is it? Phone to put on. Format font. 16 or 17. What is it? Yeah, it's done. So we are done with this session. So thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sharath. It was indeed an informative session. Hope everybody got a clear idea about the topic. He was doing it with immense effort, and it was with proper demonstrations. So as a token of appreciation and gratitude, we hereby give away a small memento. And for the same, I call upon our Managing Director of FAYA, Mr. Deepak Snath, to the floor. This is a token of approval and appreciation. I also request Mr. Siju to give away a small gift to Mr. Sharath. And to the rest, two speakers who were associated with us. Thank you so much, sir. So let's wrap up the session for today. FAYA.AT actually aims at like-minded people on the same floor to discuss on the same topic, so that it's just a small window that is open to you. You can explore it, experiment it, and learn more from yourselves. Actually, it's a flow like give and take policy. Okay? We wish that you take in and give information. You take in and give in knowledge. Okay, so we expect more and more speakers for the next sections as well. So if somebody gets idea to crack it out with others, just contact with us. We are very, very much welcoming you people to be the next speakers for the next sections. We'll be discussing many topics in the coming sessions, and even if you are not working in that area, you can join us. Let us make this much more fruitful versions. Let us bring about much more fruitful and enthusiastic versions of FAYA.AT, okay? So we are expecting so much of participation from next onwards. Thank you everybody for being here. I now thank each and every one of you for sparing time and coming here, and also thank SE Mentor for providing us this excellent speaker as well. Everybody can keep in touch with us by logging into our official Facebook page. You can get technology updates with subscribing to Techno Geeks. We will be sending you feedback mails. You may please fill in, and you can give us more improvements, suggestions for making this much more fruitful. Thank you once again, and have a good evening. Thank you all.